please, don't worry. Whatever you say, yes, ma'am. Aye, aye, sir. Okie.
Boy, I love Roger Rabbit. I am Roger Rabbit. Well, I'm not really Roger Rabbit.
Another sister. I'm here, baby.
He's Roger Rabbit. I'm Charles Fleischer. But I did create the voice of Roger Rabbit, and I did it every day live on the set when they were filming the movie. You don't believe me, do you?
No, thanks, Eddie. I may be a toon, but I'm gonna show you I can go out like a man.
I am here to give you a personally guided tour into the world of the film. I'm gonna show you who made Roger Rabbit. I just got a really good idea. I know someone whose advice would be very helpful at this point. Hey, Roger, come here, quick!
What? Out of the TV?
That's right, out of the TV, come on! Roger, I need your advice. What do you think we should cover to tell these people about how we made the movie?
I think you should show them everything. There's the animation or the sound effect for the tunes. Like... ooh, maybe show them who made the movie. I really hope my idea helped you.
Roger, I think that you and I are on the same page. Or should I say, the same frame. Hey, Rog, you want to join us?
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm going to zap you back. You ready? One, two, three. Oh, that means you too. So, here we are, inside the world of Roger Rabbit. It looks like the normal run-of-the-mill cartoon, right? Wrong.
Background and action!
So, to answer the question, who made Roger Rabbit, we really should start with the head honcho. And by that, I don't mean R.K. Maroon. This gentleman is Mr. Steven Spielberg. He was the executive producer. And here, that's Mr. Robert Zemeckis, the director. These two brilliant minds are responsible for bringing Roger Rabbit to the big screen. Allow me to introduce you to award-winning animator, Mr. Richard Williams. He was brought in to direct the animation on Roger Rabbit. His initial sketches established what Roger would look like, and it assisted the filmmakers in figuring out all the aspects of toon acting.
Wouldn't you know? Locked.
It was a big challenge trying to figure out how to take a cartoon character and a human actor and try and figure out how to put them in the same scene and make them look seamless.
The butcher, the baker, they didn't know. But the liquor store guy, he knew.
And I don't want no damn town hall. Come on,
Eddie,
get out of here. Come on.
Please, Eddie, don't stop me. You're making a big mistake. I didn't kill anybody. I swear.
Wait, hold it. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Just let me back up a little. Whoa! Long before the filming was started, a series of storyboards was created. These are simple sketches that are arranged like panels in a comic strip, and they show the filmmakers what the action is going to look like on the screen. Whoa! Now, before the animation started, the filmmakers had to shoot all of these scenes using only the human actors. Why? Because the tunes would be added in later. Let's take a look at what I'm talking about.
Take one.
Good-looking guy like that? The Danes will be breaking his door down.
Danes? What Danes? Jessica's the only one for me. You'll see. We'll rise above this piddling picadillo. We're gonna be happy again. You got that? Happy. Capital H-A-P-P-I.
When Steven Spielberg saw the first cut of the movie before the tunes were added, he said that it looked like the Invisible Man returns. To help out the actors, rubber dolls of the missing cartoon characters were used as a reference.
Towards the lens. Arm is in relationship to his eyes. So if your hand's like this, we're cutting him at the eyes, the bottom of the frame line. You gotta get that up so that, yeah.
They brought toon actors to the set to do voices while they filmed the humans.
Ha ha ha!
was wrong with that take?
Say something.
Look, Stan!
By the way, the suit was my idea. I wore it every day during filming. There were a lot of props that they didn't want the Toons to handle because, you know, you never really know what's gonna happen when Toons handle props. So what did they do? They had a special effects team come in and figure out how to move things around in the real world before the Toons were ever able to get a hold of them. How did they do it? They built mechanical devices, which then picked things up on the set. And you never get to see these contraptions in the movie because they were covered over by the animation. That is brilliant.
Thanks. I needed that.
Additionally, a group of puppeteers lent a hand in moving certain props around on wires, making it appear as if missing Toon characters were right there on the set.
We got a reliable tip-off. The rabbit was here.
You keep talking like that, and I'm gonna have to wash your mouth out.
Through the magic of the special effects team and the artistry of the puppeteers, the invisible Toons came to life. So, this robotic arm later became a plate-smashing Roger Rabbit. And this tray would soon be carried by a penguin waiter.
And these weapons would soon be wielded by Weasel.
Valiant's got him stashed somewhere.
When it came time to pull it all together, they filmed the scenes with the special effects, the actors, but no Toons.
Ready! Action! Action! Action!
And cut! How's that, Mr. Zemeckis?
Not bad.
Once again.
One more.
Once the human actors finished their scenes, the animators went into action. Director Robert Zemeckis worked very closely with Richard Williams and his team of animators to integrate the animation with the live action that had already been shot.
And the rabbit's like, doesn't want to go back in, and Hoskins is pushing him down and straining him and like just like doing like Toon squash on the top of his head.
But tell me, Eddie, is that a rabbit in your pocket or you're just happy to see me?
More than 300 of the best animators and production personnel from all over the world were brought together to work on Who Framed Roger Rabbit. To add animation to a scene, every frame of live-action footage was made into a still photograph, and then the animators had to hand-draw every frame on top of each photo. No computers were used. Now, think about that. Someone had to draw every minute movement of the Toons, frame by frame, and then hand-paint all the colors onto each cell. Okay, let's do the math and see if we can figure this out. There's 24 frames per second, which means that every 10 seconds would be 240. So,
multiply by the square root of hours in a day.
Add the percentage of coffee consumed by the animators.
The total number of cells hand-drawn for Roger Rabbit is 82,000. That's a lot. Next, every animation cell was photographed to film. And when that film is run through a projector, the animation starts to come to life. This is where most animation films have traditionally stopped. But here is where these filmmakers took it one step further. They decided to make their Toons look more lifelike than ever before. The animation and live-action footage was sent to the George Lucas Visual Effects Company, Industrial Light and Magic. The same guys who made Star Wars. It was there the animation received the final touches. Shading, shadows, and highlights were added layer by layer and then composited together to give the characters a lifelike, three-dimensional look.
I'm not bad. I'm just drawn that way.
And with every piece of the puzzle in place,
and a half years later, you've got yourself a movie called Who Framed Roger Rabbit?
So, who made Roger Rabbit? I'll tell you. Bob, Stephen, Kathy, Frank, Joanna, Bill, Dean,
Jeffrey, Frank,
Dubby, and me, Charles Fleischer. I hope you enjoyed your journey. Roger and I had an amazing time, and we would both like to thank you. Thank you from me and Roger? Roger? What are you doing? Get me out of here, will you? Don't press the remote! Roger! Put down that remote, Roger! Stop!
See you later, Charlie.